for the last 30 years or so within the American church, and I use that word loosely, there has been disputes and discussions about worship. And there has come this tag, the worship wars. And the battle has been primarily about music, about instruments that can or cannot be used in church. I'm kind of like one preacher I heard who said, I have the music taste of a 75-year-old woman. And I'm not ashamed of it. But I'm also, I think, mature enough to say that I will sing joyfully any song that exalts Christ. Amen. For that is the point, that worship is not about us, it is about the truth concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. Worship is not about merely singing songs. Worship is about the soul and the heart of man. I want you today to please open your Bibles to the 12th chapter of John and look with me in John chapter 12 today, because in this passage there is before us worship wars. There is worship in our passage. There is warfare in our passage. Now, do you see something in what we're going to look at today in John 12 and what is going on in our day? Let me just say that the common denominator then and now is this, that wherever there is worship, there is warfare. Satan fights to cloud the issue. Satan works to distract our minds and to put us into camps of, I like this, I don't like that, with no regard to what God says about it or what Jesus says about it. So I want you to stand with me, please, as we read now from John chapter 12. John chapter 12, beginning in verse 1. Then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, which had been dead, whom he raised from the dead. There they made him a supper, and Martha served. But Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled and the odor with the odor of that ointment. Then saith one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him, why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor? This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the bag and bare that was put therein. Then said Jesus, let her alone. Against the day of my burying hath she kept this. For the poor always you have with you, but me you have not always. Much people of the Jews therefore knew that he was there, and they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might see Lazarus also, whom he had raised from the dead. But the chief priests consulted that they might put Lazarus also to death, because that by reason of him, many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. Our Father, we thank you now for the reading of your word. And Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit would now arrest our hearts, our minds, our thoughts. And Father, may we be focused on the Lord Jesus. May we worship him today. And Father, we pray that if there's one here who does not know Christ, that this would be the day when they put their trust and faith in Jesus. We pray, Father, that they would come to acknowledge that he is the Son of God, the Savior of the world, and may they repent of sin and believe on the Lord Jesus. Teach us today, Lord, about worship, and may we worship you in a way that would be fitting of our wonderful Savior. For it's in his name we pray, amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. When we come to the 12th chapter of the book of John, John takes us to, at this point in the book of John, to just hours, days away from the cross. Jesus is making his way to that day when he would die for the sins of the world. But before he does, John inserts this narrative about a celebration meal that they had in the honor of Jesus. And he teaches us something in this passage about worship. I don't know what your background is, your frame of reference when it comes to worship, but I want to just walk our way through this passage today and come to understand that there was worship in this passage of Scripture and there was opposition to worship in this passage of Scripture. Where do you fit? With whom will you identify today in this passage of Scripture? The first thing that I notice is that there is an example of worship. If I were to ask you today, who is the prominent figure in this paragraph of Scripture? Who is it that stands out more than anyone else? What would your answer be? You would say, well, of course it is Mary. It is Mary that took the ointment. It is Mary that took all that she had and poured it out lavishly, extravagantly on the head of Jesus. It is Mary that wiped the feet of Jesus with her hair. She's the prominent figure in this passage of Scripture. Well, to be sure, we ought to worship extravagantly like Mary did. But don't overlook the role of Martha. You know what I believe? I believe there's some Marthas here today. I believe I've known some Marthas in my day. They're not prominent. They're not extolled. They're not exalted. They're not given a pat on the back. But the church can't do much without them. Now, notice that Martha is worshiping by the fruit of her labor. John tells us that 6 days before, this took place 6 days before the Passover feast, and Jesus came to Bethany after the raising of Lazarus. Verse 2 says they made him a supper, and obviously this was a thank you supper. Jesus had raised the brother of Mary and Martha back to life. He was dead and now he's alive, and there is a celebration and there is a thank you meal fixed, and you can imagine the mood in that room. You can imagine the jubilance, the excitement, the thrill, the gratitude, the thanksgiving that is in that room. Our brother had died, but Jesus, sitting right there, that Jesus, he's the one that came and with a loud voice called him out of the grave alive. And we're celebrating what Jesus has done. We're celebrating the goodness of the Lord. But now watch what verse 2 says. Verse 2 says, there they made him a supper. Watch this. And Martha served. Of course she did. What else would Martha do? This was Martha's area of expertise. Martha had a lifetime to subscription to Better Homes and Gardens. Martha knew everything there was to know about Pinterest. She was up to date. She was in the know. If you needed your house decorated, call Martha. If you needed a meal fixed, call Martha. If you needed your fire bed weeded, call Martha. I mean, she's it. She's on top of everything. And if there's a meal to be fixed, if there are friends to entertain, that was right down Martha's alley. And you look at that and say, well, that ain't got anything to do with worship. It's got everything to do with worship. I heard about a mother that had above her sink, back in the days before, you know, a little painting, and it said, worship services held here 3 times a day. Mama, if you can't worship while you're washing dishes, you don't know him. And here is Martha, and see, she's not gifted like Mary. She doesn't have the same personality. She doesn't have the same skills. She doesn't have the same talents. She's not Mary. She's just plain Jane Martha. Or plain Jane Martha Jane. I don't know. Anyway, she's just plain. And all she knows to do is to serve. My mother was Martha. She wouldn't lead a ladies' Bible study. That wasn't her thing. That wasn't her area of giftedness. But I want to tell you, if you needed a meal cooked, call her. If you need a baby rocked, call her. If you need a house cleaned, call her. That was her area of giftedness. That was the area that God had chosen to bless her in, and she could slap 2 dish rags together and feed an army. God blessed her that way. So here is Mary, and everybody extols the virtues of Mary, but don't you forget Martha. Martha is doing what she can. Can I tell you this? That's all God requires of you. God doesn't require a Martha to be a Mary, but God does require a Martha to do what she can. Do you ever get jealous of the gifts and talents that God didn't give you but gave to somebody else? and get so jealous, in fact, that you come to the place where you fold your arms and you say, well, if I can't have the gifts and talents she has, then I'm not going to do anything. And if you had a child that did that, you'd spank them. And yet we kind of fold our arms in disgust. We become jealous. We become irate with the Lord. Lord, if I can't do what she's able to do, then I don't want to do anything. I'm telling you, God made no mistake when he gifted you and gave you the talents that he gave you. Here is Martha. Can you imagine the hours she must have spent preparing this meal? But now I want you to imagine something else. Can you imagine the ingratitude of this family? If Jesus had come to their home after raising their brother back to life, there's no meal. There's no celebration meal. There's no acknowledgement of the goodness and the power of Jesus in their life. Well, hey, good to see you again. Glad you came by. No, that didn't happen with Martha at the house. When Martha was in the house, I'm telling you, come on in, we're going to have a party. It's going to be big. I've got the grill going. I've got every burner on the stove going. We're going to eat big. We're going to celebrate. Our brother was dead. He's alive. We thought we had lost him forever, but he's alive. And we're going to celebrate, and we're going to celebrate lavishly, extravagantly, not with perfume, but with food. Martha did what she could. Can I tell you, that's God's requirement upon our lives today. Don't try to be somebody else. Don't try to do what somebody else has done. Don't try to do something God hadn't gifted you in. Be faithful with the talents and the abilities that God has given you and serve the Lord where you are. And so in John 12, here's an act of appreciation. Here's an act of thanksgiving to the Lord for his work in their brother's life. Now look at verse 2. The Bible says, and Lazarus served, or Martha served rather, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with the Lord. Lazarus was at the meal. Lazarus was exhibit A, you remember. Jesus called him back to life. Well, how do you know? Well, there he is. We went to his funeral, and now we're at his celebration dinner. And so Lazarus is there. Now, you know, it dawned on me, and I don't want to make anything out of this. I don't think there's anything to make. But it's interesting to me that Lazarus never said anything worth recording in the Bible. And the only thing he ever did worth recording in the Bible was to die. And now here he is. He is being, he's sitting with Jesus at this wonderful meal. I think sometimes we get the idea that if we don't have the extravagant abilities and gifts, then we have no place in the body of Christ. If we don't have gifts that put us in the spotlight, then we really can't serve Jesus. Let me read you a quote from Spurgeon. Spurgeon said, there are some Christians who cannot do much or say much. Let me just let that soak in just a second, okay? The great preacher said, there are some Christians who cannot do much or say much, but their godly lives, their quiet holiness is a good witness to Jesus. See, you may not be able to do what Mary did and pour a lavish gift upon Jesus. You may not have the ability to sing a beautiful song. You may not have the ability to do what others in the body of Christ can do, but I guarantee you there's something you can do and that you ought to do and that God's requiring you to do. May not be what somebody else is doing, but I'm telling you, God has a place for you in the body of Christ. God had a role for Martha, even if it was, hey, can't you do that? Can't you discern God's gift upon your life? Can't you discern God's talent that he's given you? Find a place in the body of Christ and use it joyfully to the Lord. But now, there's a second thing I want you to see, and that is the expression of worship. We come now to Martha. The people are in the room that evening are enjoying the meal that Martha has prepared. Undoubtedly, she was a wonderful cook and could put it together quickly and beautifully. And you can imagine the conversation. You can imagine the conversation as they're celebrating, as they're eating. What a miracle. What a miracle. I never dreamed in a million years that I would see a dead man called out of the grave. But I saw it with my own eyes. There he is. You can imagine what a wonderful praise there must have been that night of Jesus. They must have shouted the praises of Jesus that night. So thankful for the work of God. And then something unexpected happens. Not only is it unexpected, but it is so very uncomfortable. Have you ever noticed who gets uncomfortable when a worship service breaks out? Not everybody's comfortable in worship. We begin to cut our eyes, nervously clear our throats, secretly judge. And we get real quiet and real uncomfortable sometimes in a worship service because that somebody else's worship is not fitting into our little box. Mary goes into a room. She comes out. She does the unthinkable. She does the unexpected. She pours this perfume upon the feet of Jesus. But Mary is not distracted. She is not deterred. She ignores the gawk. She refuses to listen to the gasp. And she continues to lavishly worship the Lord. John goes to great lengths to tell us that what she did was the perfume that she poured upon Jesus, that it was very expensive. In fact, he tells us exactly how expensive it was, that it was of great cost to her to pour out the contents of that box upon Jesus. Spikenard, 12 ounces of it. It came from India, and it was a long, drawn-out process to extract it from that plant from India. Therefore, it was very expensive. Well, John says in our text that it was very costly. If we take Judas at his word, which I don't know, but verse 5, he says that it was a year's wages. Why was this ointment not sold for 300 pence, about a year's wages? If we put all of that together, I think in today's economy, we would be well within reason to say that this cost tens of thousands of dollars. And what she does when you compare all of the gospel writers together, what she does is she breaks the alabaster box, she pours all. By the way, when she broke it, she wasn't planning on saving any of it. The box is broken. You don't put toothpaste back into a tube. When the alabaster box is broken, when the ointment begins to flow out, it's gone. You're not going to gather it back up. You're not going to put it back in the box. It is gone. And Mary gave all that she had in worship of the Lord Jesus. I think Mary reminds us that worship of Jesus is not cheap. The worship of Jesus is not easy. The worship of Jesus is not lazy. It is not casual. What does it require then to worship the true and the living God? It requires all that you are and all that you have. There's a story in the life of King David. David is bringing back the Ark of the Covenant. And he needs a place to put it before he gets back to Jerusalem. And a guy says, here's a little plot of ground. It's mine. You can have it. You can have it. Put the Ark of the Covenant there. David made a statement we need to be reminded of. David said, I will offer nothing unto my God, which does cost me nothing. Christianity is not finding a cheap way out. Christianity is not finding some casual, flippant way to worship God. The worship of God involves all that you have. It involves all that you are. You say, but I'm not giving all that I have. Then you'll never worship the true God. Where did we ever get the idea that we could dictate to God how and when we were going to worship? It is God we're worshiping. Therefore, it is God who sets the parameters of our worship. It is God who has the right to say, if you're going to worship me, this is how you got to do it. and it's going to cost you all that you have and all that you are. So Mary teaches us that she worship of the Lord involves everything. Half-hearted worship that costs nothing is not worship. Mary poured this ointment on the feet of Jesus. The people would have thought, oh no, I can't believe she's embarrassing all of us. To interrupt a celebration like this is one thing. But for a woman in public to begin to anoint the feet of a man, which was the job of a male servant, she has broken all the rules of protocol. You don't do that. And so the people are looking at her like, she's touched. She ain't right. She knows better than that. You don't wash the feet at a meal? Are you serious? You're not going to call the servant to come do that? When the guests arrive, that's when the servant comes. That's when the servant washes the feet of the guests. And now you're doing it. You're the owner of the home. And you're washing the feet of a man. What is she thinking? I don't know everything she was thinking, but let me tell you what she wasn't thinking. She didn't care what anybody thought about what she just did. It'll be a glad day in the Lord's church when we develop the discipline that we can worship God to the degree that we are oblivious to those around us. Have you ever been there? Have you ever been so enraptured in the presence of the Lord and in the worship experience that you go home at lunch and your wife says, did you see that hat she was wearing? What hat? Did you hear the choir hit that bad note? No, I was worshiping God. I wasn't. No, I didn't. Well, did you hear what they said to me? No, I was worshiping the Lord. I wasn't interested in how the choir sounded. I was worshiping God. I wasn't interested in what somebody had on. I was in the presence of the Lord. I'm telling you, when you're in the presence of the Lord, you don't care how good the singing is. When you're in the presence of the Lord, your concern is not, are they color coordinated? Your concern is, Lord, teach me how to love you better. Lord, teach me how to bask in the presence of your glory. When you're worshiping God, all these side issues are just that, side issues, and you let them go. So Mary pours all of this out in spite of it being uncomfortable, in spite of it being awkward, and it is an act of devotion to the Lord. Well, by the way, when you're engaged in the worship of God, consumed by the presence of God, you're not nearly as worried about embarrassing yourself as you used to be. There's something else I see, though, and that is she's criticized. Now I kind of see where some of the disciples might have said, I can't believe she's doing that. She's violated protocol. She's way out of bounds. Lazarus, you need to talk to your sister. Hey, and I've got one. Good luck with that. It's not good. I mean, she's made a spectacle out of herself. This is not good. You need to talk to her. But Judas speaks up. And Judas is not concerned about protocol. He's not concerned about anything except Judas. And so he begins to criticize her. Now, look what Jesus said. Jesus said, let her alone. Judas said, we could have sold this and given it to the poor. By the way, Judas didn't say that because he loved the poor. Judas said it because he's a thief. How do you know that? Jesus knew it. Jesus knew his heart. By the way, Jesus knows your heart. He knows whether you love the poor or whether you're a thief. See, he knows. He knows whether your worship is motivated out of genuine motives or whether you are just going through the process and playing a game. He knows all of that. But here's Judas, and he says, why wasn't this sold? And we could have given it to the poor. And Jesus said, let her alone. I want to tell you, you hadn't been defended until Jesus defends you. And Jesus said, let her. And by the way, you don't need to be defended unless Jesus defends you. He'll take care of it. Don't worry about it. And so he said, let her alone. Look at verse 7. Jesus said, against the day of my burying has she kept this. For the poor always you have with you. Wish the federal government would learn that. But me you have not always. It seems that Mary knew what was coming to Jesus. Maybe she's thinking about the talk is all around Jerusalem. That they're trying to trap Jesus. They're trying to arrest Jesus. They're trying to put him on a cross. And she knows that if she's ever going to anoint the body of Jesus, she's got to do it now. Time is of the essence. And so she's willing to throw aside protocol. She's willing to be embarrassed. She's willing to be talked about in order that she might lavishly pour out this ointment on the body of Jesus. By the way, I want to tell you something. The aroma of that ointment filled the room where they were. They got a little bit of that ointment on them. I'll tell you, our worship services here ought to be so powerful that people that come and don't worship, they get a little bit of worship on them anyway. So Mary, in devotion and love for the Lord, anoints his body. Mary worshiped in anticipation. He's going to die. I've got to worship him while I can. Now listen to me. I'm going to close in just a minute. Mary worshiped in anticipation. Jesus is going to die. If I'm going to worship him, I've got to do it now. We do not worship Jesus in anticipation. We worship Jesus in expectation. He's coming back. And we better worship him. We better worship him today. We better worship him tonight. We better worship him tomorrow. Whether we're changing the spark plugs on a 57 Chevy, whether we're vacuuming the floors, whether we're sacking groceries, whatever we're doing, we need to do it as we lift up our worship to the one true God. Wherever you are, whatever you're doing, do it in worship to Jesus, for he's worthy. I think one of the saddest mistakes that has developed in our lifetime, well, maybe not in our lifetime, but in the early days, the latter days rather, of Christianity, is that worship takes place at a specific location, namely the church building. And I'm telling you, that's a lie. It is a lie that you got to be here to worship God. It is a lie that if you're not in a quote-unquote church house, you can't engage God. You can't worship God. I submit to you that if this is the only place you ever encounter God in worship, your worship here lacks greatly. So Martha served the Lord with the abilities God had given her. Mary served the Lord with what God had given her. The ability to amass enough money to buy this expensive ointment. And the Bible says in verse 11, because by reason of him, many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. I hope that week after week as we go through the Gospel of John, we never lose sight of this central truth. That the Gospel of John was specifically inspired by the Holy Spirit of God to demonstrate to us that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that you might believe on him and have everlasting life. Where's that in our text? Let me tell you where it is. It's right here. Who can raise a dead man back to life but Jesus? Who is worthy of such adoration and praise and worship but Jesus? See, if God's done a work in your life, you ought to worship him. God's never done anything to you. God's never done anything for you. God has worked against you and harmed you instead of blessed you and loved you and bestowed grace upon you. No, you worship him. Why? But if God's been good to you, you ought to worship him. You ought to extravagantly, courageously, without embarrassment, worship him. He is worthy. So what think you of Christ? Is he the Son of God? If he is, then why wouldn't you believe on him and be saved today? trusting, only trusting. If you will come to Jesus, acknowledging your sin, believing on Him, He'll save you and forgive you. I want us to stand together and bow our heads. This morning we're going to have an invitation. Our choir is going to sing. Our people are going to pray. We're going to pray for you, if you don't know the Lord, that you would come, believe on Him, receive Him as your Savior. Maybe you're saved and you say, Pastor, I'm saved. I know I am. But you've never obeyed the Lord through baptism. Then why don't you come today? Come today and openly, publicly declare your faith in the Lord Jesus. You come. If the Lord's leading you to our church in a way that we receive members, then you come. Whatever God's Spirit is leading you to do, obey Him today, will you? Honor Him through your obedience. He's worthy of our all. He's worthy of our worship. Our Father, we thank You for the time we've had, and we pray, God, that we would humbly bow before You in worship, acknowledging the great and wonderful things You've done for us. And Father, all that You've done for us, You've done according to Your grace. You've saved us. You keep us saved. You supply all of our needs. You've made us to sit together in heavenly places. And it's all because of Your grace. Surely, Lord, we can humble ourselves and bow before You and extol Your greatness, worship You extravagantly. We extend this invitation, Lord, in Your name, praying Your will to be done. May we see people saved and added to the church today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Hi, I'm Roger Copeland, pastor of Northern Hills Baptist Church in Texarkana. We want to thank you for sharing in our services by means of television. Our prayer and desire is that if you don't have a faith relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, that even now you would believe on Him. The Bible says that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Wherever you are and whatever you're doing, if you will acknowledge that you're a sinner and in need of Jesus Christ, you can be saved right now by asking the Lord Jesus to save you and to forgive you of your sins. If you need help or someone just to pray with you concerning your walk with Christ, feel free to call on us, and at your convenience, we'd love to meet with you and to share God's plan for your life and to pray with you. May the Lord bless you is our prayer.